defense as any argument made in front of that jury. So here inside the courtroom in Kellen Winslow II's trial, prosecutors want to put in some evidence involving the defendant's computer and some images or searches from his computer that they say is indicative of someone like him who they are calling a serial sex offender. Let's go back into the courtroom and listen to those arguments.
All right, next is motion number three. I'm skip over that. That's the 1108 evidence. I'll get back to that in a moment. I kind of want to run through these other ones. Aren't going to take so much time. There's evidence of some porn research of some sort that forms the basis for the motion number four, which is the motion to exclude evidence related to internet pornography searches. I don't know anything about this. I haven't seen any of the evidence. Maybe it's been provided in discovery. So, Mr. Owens, can you enlighten the court as to what you have and what you plan on offering?
I can, Your Honor. The people would seek to at least have the evidence available for potential introduction. What the evidence is simply numerous searches on the part of Mr. Winslow on a home computer that have been seized from his residence during the execution of a search warrant that shows, I would characterize it as an extensive quantity of pornography to ensure that there's no misinformation that's been disseminated by the media. There is no pornography involving elders that has been located on any of the electronic devices seized at Mr. Winslow's home. But I would inform the court that the people believe that Mr. Winslow's sexual preoccupation and sexual propensity will be an issue over the course of the case, and most certainly will be if the defense ends up retaining experts and proceeding with some form of mental defense. So I just ask the court to reserve on the issue until we have more information exchanged in discovery and whether or not the people truly believe it's relevant and whether we even seek to introduce it.
Okay. Do you at this point plan to introduce it in your case in chief?
Not in my case in chief, but I would reserve on the issue if it may be something I'd like to use in a rebuttal,
okay,
or as impeachment. And then certainly I may be seeking to introduce it in my case in chief if they do decide to run a mental defense.
Okay. So for now, the motion to exclude that evidence is granted. Without prejudice, there will be no mention of it in opening statements, and of course, none of it will be presented to the jury without first bringing to the court and counsel's attention. I know you would do that anyway, but just to be clear, you just can't spring on the witness without prior approval. So the motion is granted without prejudice to renew the motion. Should there be some sort of, I guess you're anticipating maybe some sort of mental defense that might make it relevant?
Correct,
your door is opened through the defense case, correct?
Correct, Your Honor, but or if indeed, based upon the cross-examination of the people's witnesses, if it seems to suggest they're going to be claiming some mistaken, albeit reasonable, belief in consent on the part of the victims, then it may prove relevant during the people's case in chief.
Okay.
But I would bring it to the court's attention before we do that.
All right. So Ms. Barney, satisfied with that? It's granted for now.
Yes.
And if the prosecution feels the door has been opened, we can revisit the issue. All right, then we'll move on to motion number five. That's a motion to preclude any reference to the homeless status of the complaining witnesses. Do you want to get heard then on that?
Yes, Your Honor. The people's motion refers to the transient status of Jane Doe's number one and number two. First, Jane Doe number one is not transient, and she shouldn't be grouped as such. Jane Doe lives with her mother. She has an address.
She spends a lot of time on the streets, but she's not homeless, so to speak.
She may be walking around, but on this particular occasion, she was walking from her home to the store. It was hot. She wanted to get a ride. But she's not homeless or transient. But as to Jane Doe number two, her housing status is irrelevant. It has no bearing on Mr. Winslow's identity, intent, or motive. The government asserts that the housing status is probative of whether either of them consented, but our position is that housed and unhoused people can be equally consenting or unconsenting, and our objection to this characterization is that it's not probative of any disputed fact, and its only purpose or effect is to elicit sympathy for either of those two.
Okay, all right, Mr. Owens.
I would submit to the court that it's certainly relevant, both as to the status of Jane Doe 1 and Jane Doe 2. First, Jane Doe 1 did describe herself as being transient when she first reported to law enforcement that she did have a address that was available to her, but that she did spend time on the street, so that's where that comes from. Jane Doe 2 most certainly is transient and self-identifies as being homeless, if you will, using that term. I think that it's going to be particularly relevant in this case because, at least as it relates to Jane Doe 2, there was a prior incident where Mr. Winslow, in fact, offered her a ride and then drove her to a homeless shelter, that he had offered her food and money on repeated occasions prior to the alleged rape. Plus, in terms of the circumstances surrounding Jane Doe,